Welcome to the Prog Talks by the Prog Space. Welcome to the Prog Talks, an interview series by the Prog Space, where we will be talking to musicians in all corners of the progressive music scene. Welcome everyone to the Prog Talks, again with your host Rune, Uncle Prog, and today I have some very interesting musicians guest me here on the Prog Talks from Danish band Iotunn, which is, I would say, is a real comet upcoming band that's really struck hard into the progressive music and progressive metal scene. So welcome, guys. How are you doing?
Thank you, Rune. We're doing great here in Copenhagen. The album came out just 2-3 weeks ago now, and the response has been great. So in terms of that, we're doing absolutely great.
Yeah. So of course I should introduce you guys. The guy who just talked, that's Eskil Rask, which is the bassist, and a new addition to the band, somewhat new addition to the band. And then of course we have on the other side here Jens Nicolai, who is the guitarist and one of the founders. Isn't that right, Jens Nicolai?
Yeah, somewhat. I would say that Jesper and Bjorn are the real founders.
I see.
That time in the band goes back to 2009, and I joined the band in 2011. But I, on the other hand, I would consider myself a founder in the aspect that. That the sound that we have tried to create during the last 10 years is something that basically, you know, comes from my brother Jesper and my, you know, kind of writing, the way we write riffs and arrange the early stages of the song ideas.
Exactly. So I was looking into the band, of course, and I found the EP from 2016, and the Metal Archives, who is usually a very good indicator or can give a lot of good information. They told me that they had the starting point of the band in 2015, but that's not completely right then. So would you tell me a little bit about those early stages of the band and, you know, what led up to the point we're at now?
Sure. It's always, especially when you deal with so many years that I believe that 10 years or 11 years is, hard to, you have to draw some lines in the sand here and there, you know, in terms of defining new periods. A defining line for us is the line in 2015, because that was the year that we decided to name ourselves Iotunn. Mm-hmm. So that's why we have decided to, you know, to mark 2015 as the beginning of Iotunn, so that from 2009 until 15. That's more of a, on a creative level, that's more, you could call it formative years.
Yeah, I see.
Because it was not really Iotunn. We had different band names, and we were basically just a laboratorium at you know, we were just exploring different expressions within the realms of heavy music and rock music, especially 70s rock music and prog rock and stuff like that, but also folk rock, and we have been everywhere. So
I see.
So
this this earlier incarnation, did you record anything, demos or anything with that, or was that something did you play live, and how much of a band was it in that regard before you decided to go for the Iotunn, the full Iotunn experience?
Basically, since 2009 and the following years, the lineup was always complete.
Yeah.
Before I joined in 2011, I know that Jesper Bjørn and the band at that time had created an album, which was Scratch. And then I joined and we created an EP with a rock band we called Electric Sky with four tracks in it.
Hmm.
And released that and played some gigs in Denmark. But it never... We didn't feel like we were finalized or that we were had arrived at home, so to speak, yet.
I see.
It still felt like on a very, you know, very deep level that we were still in the search for
evolving.
For what that we believed we were really about.
Hmm.
But we didn't know at the time. So on one hand, we recorded and created music, and on the other hand, we knew deep inside that we just had to be patient, because at some point, you know, there must be something that really catches our attention and feels like this is what it's all about. And we went into a studio in 2012, I think, in Aarhus, and recorded an entire album.
Mm-hmm.
With another band, but same lineup.
But I see.
Where everything had become a bit more progressive and a bit harder, and there were also some metal elements. And then, just when we had mastered that album, we scratched that one.
Oh, so it never was released?
Nope, it was not good enough. It was a very good album, but we didn't feel it was good enough.
Well, I think I've heard that album, actually.
Yeah.
In Nicolai, is that the Albatross album?
That's the Albatross album.
Yeah, I think I've heard that one. There's a lot of very good riffs, and for sure I'll say it does sound... There's a lot of user identity in that album.
You're making me very curious now, of course. Yeah. let's move past that into current day, because you released your album across all worlds just like there's about a month ago, right? The 26th of February was the release date for the album.
Exactly,
and
yeah.
I think, you know, I've read about you, seen you, and people are talking about you everywhere within the progressive community. How are you yourself feeling this, you know, the reception that you've had to the release of the album?
I think it's... One thing that's very cool about the modern age and the use of internet is that the connection between followers and artists is very close, and anyone can write directly to us on Facebook or Instagram or Bandcamp if they want to, and we can see what they have to say. People tag us in Instagram posts playing their newly acquired vinyl edition and vinyl edition, and that's really cool to see how many people are actually getting in touch and tagging us and mentioning us. We can see it in a way that's really, really cool to see.
Yeah, but not only that fan base, you know, you see like quite big publications and stuff within progressive music and metal also has, you have caught their eye, so to say. These people seem interested.
Yeah, it's fun because a couple of times I have experienced that when I say that we are, you know, a bit... not overwhelmed, but they're surprised by the very good reviews.
Yeah,
I get the response. Yeah, but didn't you expect that? You know, we expected a good response for this album because we have been working several years on this album, and we have heard the music over and over again, like a zillion times. And you know, sometimes we just want to, you know, clear our heads and, you know, it's enough is enough.
Mm.
I will never hear that song again, you know, but you know, we always have to come back to it again and again. And for us, it always sounds fresh to us. And some of these songs, we know these songs for maybe three, or not, some of the ideas maybe for 3, 4, maybe 5 years.
Mm.
And to this day for us, the ideas are still strong. So time haven't run out on the ideas or left the ideas behind. So we are pretty confident about the material. So we expected some good response on it. But that being said, the response have been overwhelming. And of course, you have on one hand, you have the critics. Crazy good reviews on this album,
all over the place.
I think we have beyond 50 rated reviews right now.
That's fantastic.
And if you try to find the average score on a scale from 0 to 10, we are about 8.7, 8.8 or something like that.
Yeah, that's what I feel as well. From all the reviews I've written, they all rate you between 8 and 10 if on that scale.
It's crazy. But what really matters to us is the personal messages we get and some of the stuff that some people are writing out there, where they say that this music have given them, you know, the inspiration to really listen to music again after several years of not feeling inspired. And so there's also some crazy comparisons to other bands, legends that we highly respect. And there's a few people also says that their mood or their you know, they feel that their being is more well because of listening to this music, that we are helping on the mood department.
Exactly, and that can be needed now. You know, I think a lot of people are struggling with their mood and their. It's been a rough year for, I think, for a lot of people, and music has been there for many of us to keep, you know, lifting us up and giving us a bit of, you know, either release or like an hour away from reality to go into some of those other worlds that you are transporting us to with your album. So I just have to ask then, because your music is sort of understandable to me now that I hear how long you have been working on the album. The music is incredibly atmospheric, but at the same time, it's complex, it's heavy, all that stuff. What goes into writing a Iotunn track or Iotunn's music? How does the process work for you guys? Are you a band that sits on your own? Are you jamming things out in a rehearsal space? How do you work on your music?
It starts out with Jesper, my brother, and I. We spend a lot of time at our apartments and sit and jam. And we also write separately, but we always catch up at these songwriting, days where we spend, sometimes we sit from 12 o'clock to 12 o'clock in the night, you know, 10, 12 hours.
I see.
So I would say from the point of zero until there's something to work on, that is determined by guitar riffs and guitar ideas, basically. So that's one step. And sometimes, you know, a song writes itself, so that one riff or one idea morphs into other ideas and they all feel connected.
Mm-hmm.
And other times we have to put pieces together. And you can also hear that on the album. There's some drastical changes in the music here and there, but there's also very coherent pieces of music where it changes, but it sounds like it's all familiar, or you know, everything has the same DNA despite all the changes and all the different genres. We we don't really go with any rules regarding genres or expressions. We just have to like it and feel it. That's all. So we don't care with what kind of music we're playing, basically. So whether it's a death metal riff or a thrash riff or classic metal riff, new wave of British heavy metal riff, or anything, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
If we can feel it, we think it's good, we take the chance and go forward.
Yeah.
Yes, then it's included, and from there on we try to come with suggestions for arrangements, which is only based on the guitar parts.
Okay. Yeah.
So that's the first very big step, and I think we are pretty efficient. We don't have writer's block very often. When we grab our guitars, we write and create. Yeah. A lot of it is crap, but we create. So we are not short on ideas.
Yeah, that leads me into another part of my, because that was also something I wondered. Some bands say that they stick with their ideas no matter what, and they like bend and shape them into something they can use. Then you have other bands that, you know, they throw away a lot of stuff. Are you more on that second part, that you come up with a lot of ideas and then some stay and a lot gets thrown out, or?
Yes, definitely, because sometimes, and that's very rare, but sometimes an idea needs to, we need to have days to think about an idea so that it can grow, or sometimes it needs more work, and we have to, bend it and shape it onwards towards something that can
exactly,
be used.
Yeah.
But the way that I prefer to write riffs is that is just to plug in and play.
Yeah.
And not think too much, just play something. And normally when I play, after 30 seconds, I know, okay, this is not it. Next thing.
I see.
And then when I hit something that works, I give it 5 minutes, maximum 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And if it's not working, next thing.
I see. Yeah. So you know quite quickly if it works, if you feel there's something there, you explore it a little bit more. But then also you have another limit where you're like, okay, this still isn't something. So I guess it's like then a lot of ideas are getting left behind, but some of them you're happy with and you bring them forward into a band context.
For me, it just results in that if I sit for a couple of hours and write riffs,
yeah,
I with this method I often have maybe I don't know 5 or 6 very good riffs.
I see,
and Jesper, that's a bit the same, so if we work for a month's time, have a good month. Sometimes that can go several weeks where we don't write anything.
Yeah.
And then there's
suddenly
like three or four days and we have 50 ideas, So so it's really just a matter of having confidence in yourself as a writer, so that you don't have to rush things or stress things out, but you can, take your break and say, okay, I don't have to write anything this week. And then naturally you feel like, okay, I feel like it now. And then
it comes.
When I say, then it's just a matter of, pulling yourself together and just do it, write something instead of waiting and sitting. Oh, what is this about? Then just do something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I want to jump a bit forward and to you guys released an EP in 2016. Then that's right after you had taken the Iotunn name, right? And there you had someone else doing the vocals and the bass, and then now you have Eskil here on bass guitar, and you have Jon Aldara, which is probably known from Ham Fighted for a lot of listeners. So how was that experience for you, Eskil, to be recruited into the band, or what happened there? How did you get in touch with these guys?
That was a very cool experience. They got in touch with me, I think, in late summer 2019. I had known the guys since 2016. Actually, played a few shows with them with Sunday Storm, and I've also helped out as a stand-in bassist for a single show in 2016 too. So I've known the guys for some years.
I see. Yeah.
In 19, Jesper called me one evening. I hadn't talked to him in maybe a year or so. Then he just called me out of the blue and he said, "Eskil, we've recorded a whole album on guitars and drums, and we are working with Jon on vocals. And we'd really like you to play bass on it." and that was very interesting. So I got Jesper to send me some demos, and those demos were for Waves Below from the album, and Access All Worlds, the second track on the album. And I just heard the first 15 seconds on Waves Below and said, "Yep, I'm in." And I had to call Jesper and say, let's do it. And then I came to the rehearsal studio, to the Iotunn studio, and we listened through the album and had a beer and talked things through. And I said I'd take a listen to the whole album. And there was one track, the Weaver System, when we listened to the whole album, that really struck with me. It has this, it's like the most melodic, most calm song of the bunch, and it has this really great lead melody on guitar during the chorus, and that just really struck a nerve with me. So I think I was home at 11 that same night, and at 2 or 3 in the night, I sent the guys a demo for that song. That was the first thing I sent just the same night that we had met. And that is more or less the version of the Weaver System that's on the album now. So that was really just inspiration that struck there, and I think that speaks volumes about the music.
That's interesting that you say that, because the Weaver System and of course Waves Below must be my favorite track on the album. You know, it's just such an atmospheric, you know, complex. It goes to places you don't expect it to, but it stays with, it's just very, very, very good. So I can vividly imagine you getting excited when you heard that track from the guys, and but you were the last person to be recruited into this incarnation of Iotunn then, because you guys already had Jon Aldara in the band at that point. So how did that come about?
We had to figure out what to do with, you know, this band. Yeah. And in 2017, and Jon was just at the top of our wish list from day one. We tried some others also, because we hesitated a bit about contacting Jon, because, you know, we had to find strength in our confidence, and he's, you know, he's very well established already, and at that time, and you know, and to me also, and to the other guys, he's maybe metal music's best singer of our generation.
Yeah, you know, I agree with that. Yeah,
yeah, you know. The metal generation born in mid 80s, during the 80s, that he's the guy. So we are all you know, more or less on the same age, you know, at the same age, and so many things just made sense for us when we were thinking of what it would be if we had him in our band. And we had met him a couple of times at Hamfat gigs, and he loved Iotunn at that time also, and knew us. And we've heard Hamfat a couple of times, and we wanted a singer that could perform extreme vocals and clean vocals.
Yeah.
And who's a reliable performer live. With a lot of charisma surrounding him, and also we wanted a singer who's a good lyricist and a good good at telling a great story. So he was just the man to go to for us, and so finally after Hamfat show in February in Copenhagen, Jesper wrote him and sent him the demo tracks for Tower, Weaver, and Safe Across.
Mm-hmm.
The last three songs on the record. And on paper, he didn't have the time for us. But he said, it's too good to say no. He said, this music is just, on all parameters, just the kind of music that I love.
That must have boosted your confidence quite a bit as well, to have someone like him.
It was a great day, and to this day, and I think until the day that we retire, it will be one of the highlights of our career. Having him joining our band, that's for sure.
If you are enjoying this interview, please head over to theprogspace.com for more reviews, articles, pictures and interviews all about progressive music. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. theprogspace.com.
He said, my schedule is packed, so I can't start. I 2018 is packed for me.
Yeah, impossible.
So you have to wait.
Yeah.
You have to wait for me.
Yeah.
And we said, fine, that's no problem at all. So he came to Copenhagen in June 2018 and met with us for a meeting, where we just discussed perspectives and ambitions for the band, and discussed the album and stuff like that. And we could just feel it, all of us, that this will work.
This was right.
So So the album process with him started in the last weekend of November 18. And for the coming year, in about 10, 11, 12 weekends maybe, he flew to Copenhagen. With his high spirits and
yes,
his laptop.
Exactly.
and we went into the studio, our own studio, and then on the spot we just had these very creative moments where we just listened to the music over and over again. He said, "Can you please set that part on repeat?"
Mm.
So we took the chorus for Gargantua 1, and this was just repeating. And he sat there just staring, out in the blue, so to speak. And he looked down his laptop and, started to write lyrics. And we sat there, what's going on? And just waited for something. And it could be clean singing, it could be growl, it could be everything, he can everything. Let's see what he has in the pocket. And then he just he raises his hand and say, "Hey guys, can you start the music?" "Yeah, sure. I think I have an idea." "Okay, great." And that was the entire process all the way through all the weekends. He's writing the lyrics at the same time as he listens to the music and come up with all these brilliant ideas. It's some of the best workmanship I have ever seen, or craftsmanship I have ever seen within creating music in my all of my life. And those weekends were just so fun. very stimulating when we worked on the music. And afterwards, we would go home to our apartments and have parties and or go into the city and to concerts. This was before Corona.
Yeah.
So it was just all those weekends were magic.
I see. Yeah. Well, I must say he does an amazing job on the album, and I'm interested as well in you mentioned the lyrics, him writing the lyrics, because it seems like, you know, your band has the name Iotunn, which of course is taken from Norse mythology. Is the sort of the ancestral enemies of the Norse gods, giants, and I wonder, is this something with the Norse mythology? Is it something that is sort of further explored within your band, within your lyrics, within the themes, or is it something that personally or spiritually means something to you who are in the band?
I think there is a fact that while the Norse god represents some sort of order,
yes,
the Jotun or the giants represent more a sense of chaos.
Mm-hmm.
And listening to the album, I think it's one thing that's very pronounced is how it's very creative and it's going in very many directions. I think reading through reviews, some reviewers try to define a genre and most give up. Mm-hmm. You see a lot of reference. Some people call it progressive extreme metal or all kinds of different power thrash, death,
yeah,
black
I've
metal.
I've seen a lot of different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we've chosen to go with just progressive metal.
Yeah.
To be able to fathom, you know, that this goes in very many directions, this album. I think there is this element of chaos is from the giants, from the
Jotun, yes.
Exactly. Is represented in that way in the album Access All Worlds. And I think there's also, from what I've gathered in the years I've known the guys in Jotun, and also how it's been the last what's it been, 1.5 years since we started talking, is there is in everything that's written some sort of close spiritual Nordic touch in this, and that's also the Norse mythology thing that may or may not, you know, find its way into some of the concepts of future music that's written.
Yeah, because when I read Access All Worlds, I sort of got in my head, you know, the nine worlds of the Norse mythology and all this as well. But I think we are dealing with a unique cosmology here. Like there's a, if not a concept album, there's a theme connecting this and also connected to the cover art and everything, right?
Sure, sure. That's for sure. As Eskil said, the expression in the music combines greatly with the band name, but we wouldn't, I think, consider ourselves a Viking band or a Viking themed band like that. Like we are, you know, like our perception of life is only rooted in the Northern mythology.
Yeah.
That's not the case. The chaos aspect is very important, that metaphorically the Jotuns, you can always count on them creating chaos or stir things up.
Yeah, rebelling against...
Yes, yeah. So in terms of our lyrical content or our musical expressions, you know, this first album is what this first album is, because that was what it became. So maybe the next album, you know, will have a very different production. Or what do I know?
Yeah.
We can never, you know, it's a work in progress always, and to feel free in these processes, you have to. We aim for totally freedom, so that we don't like to be put in boxes. We like to floor, floor around.
Break out of it.
So that is what I connect with the band name, basically. And in so many aspects, just, you know, the fact that keeping a band together and have this together and experience all this, and it's enormous. It's so Jotun meaning, so that, you know, meaning giant, it also metaphorically, you know, represents all the gigantic aspects of all this crazy stuff we're doing right now. And it's very interesting in terms of the connection to this album, especially, and to the Access All World title. You asked about, you know, beliefs, or, you know,
philosophical themes or
philosophical themes or stuff like that. And we are five very different individuals in our band, and we all have this, you know, Jotun being derived from Old Norse.
Yes,
we still in our lyrical content we raise questions, and we are, you know, walking around themes that are universal and that can apply to anyone. So we are not, you know, we don't want to build this northern wall, you know. No. We don't want any borders. So inspiration for us is not only derived from you know, Nordic culture or Nordic history. It's, you know, it can be ancient texts or ancient religious texts. Exactly. Or literature or poetry, and you know, there's so many sources to inspiration for you know, spiritual or philosophical guidelines or ways to see the world to wonder about what it is to be a being. So in that term also, we don't want too much order. We want to be able to see all the dynamics. You know, the northern cultures, and they are not just northern, and the Nordic northern mythology is not just northern mythology. It's very, very much inspired, or maybe even created from a lot of stuff going on down in southern Europe and the Middle East. So on the bigger scale, everything is connected.
Exactly.
Access All Worlds, the title. You know, there is a specific storyline going throughout the album, which, you know, definitely makes it a concept album.
Yes.
But my interpretation is that, you know, that's just, that's just one side of the coin.
Yeah, the front of the building, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. If you see the entire album, see the question that is being raised and the themes that are being is found in the concept of the lyrics, and you start to find I think some of the metaphorical meanings in all the different planets and maybe even see the entire album as an analogy. It's about accessing a lot of worlds out there, but the other side of the coin, you know, the entire album is a mirror for each individual to look inside themselves. So the travel that goes out there is, on the other hand, the travel that goes inwards
inside. As well. Yeah,
exactly.
It's very, very interesting and very. When you talk about this, especially as you started out talking about, like, that you don't consider yourself a Viking band, which I would never really pigeonhole you as one either, but it brings to mind a band like Enslaved, right, that started out as a very Viking focused band and now is more about, like, the philosophical side of you know, Norse mythology or Norse teachings, without, you know, having to sing about Vikings all the time or whatever. So in the same regard, I feel this is a very, like, there's a very, like, Nordic Norse feeling that I can also find in other like Norwegian and Swedish Swedish bands that has somewhat at least some of the same atmosphere as your music. How do you feel about being like compared against bands like that? You know, people mention Opeth, they mention Bodyknagar or Enslaved. What is your thoughts on that?
Proud, I'd say, in a positive sense. That's just very flattering. It could be said in a negative way. I haven't seen that. Nobody has said that we're just another Opeth copy band or anything like that. It has been purely honest and positively versed comparisons, and that's just. Those are really good comparisons, I think, and I'm happy to see those kinds of to see us compared to those kinds of names. Absolutely.
Yeah, it's a big honor. That's for sure. It brings different vibrations into the band, you know, because bands like some of the bands mentioned, like you said, Opeth or Bognagar,
or Enslaved,
or Arcturus or Primordial, it's those kind of bands that I would call bulletproof bands. You know, they always deliver.
Yeah,
and so on one hand, it's, you know, we are very flattered, but on another hand, you know, we have to be realistic, you know, and I love the praise because it means basically that people are happy about our music, and for that we are very proud. But this is just our debut album, you know. Yeah. What have Enslaved, like 15 albums, 14
yes,
or
something like that? Yes.
You know, it's so ironically, you can make fun of it and say, okay, but that's good, very, very good for now, but let's see if they think the same when the second album comes, you know.
I see, yeah.
We have, you know, it's we have just you know, we have just planted the seed.
Exactly.
Yes, and they already have, you know, big gardens. So, so it's very different, but it makes us very confident about what we're doing. That so positive reactions are coming, you know, in the light of that. This is just our debut album. This is the first album.
Well, I want to talk a little bit about that seed and that, you know, that boat setting sail or whatever we should call it. Because, of course, with the pandemic going on, I'm guessing you guys had plans for what you wanted to do when the album was released. I'm sure you had intended to play live, hopefully do gigs and concerts and festivals. But now that's sort of on hold, at least for now. So, what does the future hold now for Iotunn? What is your plans coming up during the first half now and into 2021?
For now, I think as you guessed correctly, that we had a lot of plans for the first half of 2021 that have now been cancelled and then postponed, and I think most recently is the festival in Aarhus in Denmark, a Royal Metal Fest that has been cancelled that we were really looking forward to. But of course, everything is not cancelled, it's postponed, and most of these things are going to happen just at some point later in time. And all of the as of yet unannounced plans we have had for the release of the album and what would happen beyond that and live shows are still going to happen just also later in time. I think we have some very exciting things.
I'm hoping and guessing that you guys are also writing new music, right, for a follow-up.
Yeah,
definitely.
We are right now. We I think Bjorn, right now, Bjorn, our drummer, is building a completely new studio, a drum recording studio. And I think he's maybe a couple of weeks from, you know, the
finishing the point.
I think so. Bjorn will do drums for one track, I know, for the demo. And then we have the entire demo process, you know, well started.
We have
already guitar and drums recorded for 6 demo tracks, and we have an acoustic song, and then this song. And Eskil has just started working on the bass for one song is finished, and we have another one that is you are working on right now, and so during spring I think we will have all demos ready for the entire album except vocals, and then we will spend the summer listening very carefully to these demos and figure out you know, talk back and forth very much with Jon to hear what are you feeling about this and what can we do with the vocals and stuff. And then the plan right now is that Bjorn will just record the drums during summer. And then, and that's all, you know, it's a big load of work doing all the guitars and stuff like that. But,
yes. But
the plan is that during late summer and autumn, we have all the guitars recorded. For the extra album.
Yeah, for the, yes, exactly.
And then late this year and during next year, when time is for it, we will work on vocals and stuff like that. So hopefully, if everything goes well, we can release the second album during 2023.
Okay, well, that's I'm already looking forward to that, I have to say, because this debut album Access All Worlds is just been a fantastic album. It's very early in 2021, but it's already one of my favorites. So, well, I have to also just quickly ask Eskil, because you know I'm also a big fan of your other band, Sunless Dawn. So yeah. And I'm wearing the shirt, of course, because my Iotunn shirt isn't in yet, so I'm representing. And so I just want to quickly ask you, how is the Sunless Dawn camp doing? Are you also working on new stuff, hopefully?
I think we are, if very slowly. I think other priorities have taken over, but we're definitely not dead. Sunless Dawn is living its own slow life, and I think you know Time Weaver. It's quite the prog odyssey,
yes.
Very complex music, and much the same as Access All Worlds. It was a record that took a very long time to compose and record. And I think if there's going to be a Time Weaver 2 or a follow up to that, it's also going to take some time for that to be out. But I don't think Christopher, who's the main composer, is ever going to stop writing music. So.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. I can expect more music in the future from Sunless Dawn and, of course, from Jotun, which I'm very excited about. And until then, I think everyone should have a listen to Access All Worlds, because it's a complete experience, fantastic album. Thank you so much, guys, for being on here with me. And it was a joy talking to you.
Thank you,
Rune.
Thank you very much.
A pleasure.
The Prog Talks, produced by The Prog Space. Main host, Rune Belsvik Reinås. Produced by Rune Belsvik Reinås, Vanessa and Matthias Kirsch. All graphics and animations by Vanessa Kirsch. Intro theme by Giuseppe Negri. Outro theme by Zach Munowitz. This was The Prog Talks by The Prog Space. See you in a week.